be frightened, and do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go.
Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Nothing can separate us from his love. Amen?
Amen.
We're here to celebrate this morning. I have a question to ask you. What is the one thing God wants from us more than anything else? Exactly. And we're singing this morning, God with us. He came as a baby in a man. Dwell with us. What a concept. And he wants a relationship with us. Would you stand as we sing, Who Are We? We are God's creation. Sing this with me. Who are we that you would be mindful of us? What do you see that's worth looking away? We are free in ways that we never should be. From the grip of the chain, like angels straining from the waves, my heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries for you alone.
Lay at your feet.
more time, all that is within me, Christ.
Of all that is within me, Christ, for you alone be glorified, Emmanuel. God with us.
Repeat that line, Emmanuel,
Emmanuel, God with us.
You are Emmanuel, declare it.
You are Emmanuel, God with us.
Father, we pray that you will take what we are about to give and bless it. Use it for ministry purposes. Use it to make a difference in the lives of others. Use it, Father, to bring glory to your name. We pray in the giving and loving name of Jesus our Lord. Amen.
No.
Thank you, ladies, and my thanks to all of you for your help with the offering today. There is one other piece of information that I meant to say thank you for. You need to know that in last year's pledge campaign, well, a good campaign company will tell you that if you raise 90 to 95% of what is pledged, you've done very well. We raised 97% of what was pledged. And that is, again, a testament to your faithfulness, to your commitment to stewardship, and thank you so much. This morning, I'd like for us to go to the book of 2 Corinthians, a letter from Paul to the church at Corinth. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 6 through 10, and let's stand as we read the word together. Paul has just gone through two or three things that have happened in his life that if he wanted to boast, if he wanted to brag, if he wanted to be a little bit arrogant, he could be. Not that he will, not that he does, not that he wants to, but he's trying to confront and, well, just make an argument against what's going on in the church at Corinth in regard to some of the boasting that's going on. And he says, even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool because I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain, so no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say, or because of these surpassingly great revelations. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. Let me read that sentence again. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight. Can you do that? Because listen to the list. I delight for Christ's sake in such things as weaknesses, insults, hardship, persecution, difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Father, may your Spirit speak to our hearts today in a way like never before. May we be listening to what you have to say to us individually and to us as a congregation. We pray in your great name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, we're still kind of focusing on that relationship, are we not? That relationship that will do many things, that relationship that is above all other relationships, and that relationship which will maximize your weaknesses. Before a person can experience any of the blessings and cash in on any of the promises of God, there must be a relationship established. That relationship is essential. But to better understand how this relationship will grow and develop, we need to look back a few years. We need to rethink the arrival of Jesus Christ into this world. I know it's still a few weeks until Christmas, but let's go back anyway. Let's go back for just a moment, if you would, please, because the arrival of Jesus on the earth was not normal. Even in that day and time, even 2,000 years ago, it was not normal to be born in a barn. That just wasn't part of the plan for anybody, especially for the King of Kings. But the circumstances warranted it. Instead of military might, financial security, and political nobility, Jesus arrived in the midst of weakness, poverty, and social disgrace. His birth, however, serves as a teaching moment. A teenage mother with almost nothing going for her. Mary and Joseph, at the time that they were supposed to offer a sacrifice for this new child that had come their way, instead of being able to offer a sacrificial lamb, they had to settle for the lesser offering of two birds. Two birds. Now, in the ranking, that's pretty low. The sacrificial lamb was what was expected, but there was provision in the Levitical law for something less if you couldn't afford a lamb. They couldn't. They could barely afford to pay for the two birds that were given as the sacrifice for the arrival of their son, Jesus. And the irony of all that is, the parents of the sacrificial lamb of the world didn't have a sacrificial lamb to offer on his behalf. Well, that's just part of the setting. At Christmas, we'll be focusing on the image of a serene, sweet, quiet, adorable manger scene. Can I read that again? We'll be focusing on the image of a serene, sweet, quiet, adorable manger scene. Folks, it was a barn. Sweet, serene, quiet. Do those really fit the description? It was a barn. It was a smelly barn where our Lord arrived. It smelly and dirty, and the aroma of mandels would not have overpowered that smell. You know what a mandel is? It's a candle for men. Some of you ladies are getting ready to shop, are you not? Little early Christmas help here. There's the one called Treehouse. One called black leather. I have no idea what the difference in smell between black leather and brown leather is. The bottom left, blind barber. What is that? Blood? Hair clippings? I couldn't figure that one out. These truly are the mandel brand. The carnivore, the biker, the grease monkey, game day. So let me offer you a couple of more suggestions, if I may. If you're going to set up a nativity scene, you may want shepherd sweat, dirty donkey, and hay bale heaven. Just a thought. You know, I really am the poorest preacher they've had in a while, aren't I? Why? Why poverty? Why a stable? Why this direction? Did something go wrong? Did God's plan misfire? Was there a mistake made in heaven? Did the plans get thwarted at the last second? Did something take place that turned this thing in a direction no one intended? Hardly. You see, God chose weakness as the best setting to display His strength. And weakness creates the space that God fills with His strength. The idea of weakness being something to celebrate is not just counterintuitive, it's countercultural. In our world, strength is valued, not weakness. And when Paul wrote to the church at Corinth, he knew the idea of celebrating weakness would be difficult to swallow. Paul had learned the hard way that the entry point for experiencing the strength of God is by personal weakness. He had experienced plenty. He was a man who had a lot of self-confidence, a self-drive, self-driven man, but he had learned that weakness is the entry point for the strength of God into the heart and life of the individual. Corinth was known for its lavish lifestyle. It was a city where success and accomplishments were applauded heartily. And admitting weakness, well, it was just that. It was a sign of weakness. Nobody was doing that in Corinth. Nobody of any stature, at least. And this is why so many are reluctant, even in our day and in our time, to enter fully into the relationship that we've been talking about. They're reluctant because they don't want to confess or admit weakness, and they're afraid that if they testify to some weakness that God may have to use, that they may be rejected or ignored or turned away for some reason. In 2 Corinthians 11:16 and the verses that following, that follow, Paul addresses this issue. And take time this coming week to read those verses as part of your homework. But in he begins by writing about boasting. And it's to help the readers understand that he, Paul, had a lot to boast about. There were some things that happened in his life that were unbelievable. There were some experiences that he had gone through that were, well, really, if you had experienced them, it would have taken about 10 minutes for you to find somebody to tell about them. But on this day, he's telling about things that happened years ago. He has written in this letter about things that happened years ago and announcing them, as far as everyone understands, announcing them for the very first time. He's kept it a secret all this time in order to not boast, in order to not brag about his personal accomplishments and his personal achievements. He takes this route of silence. But the time has come for the word to get out. All of these people are boasting about what they've done and what they've accomplished and what's been done under their strength and their ability. And he says, now wait a minute. Wait just a minute. Let me tell you something. If I wanted to boast, I could. And here are some of the things. And they are in amazement as they hear this letter being read in the church. They are in amazement. Did he say that? Someone taps the reader on the shoulder and says, would you read that again? Did that really say what we think we heard you just say? And he says, yes, it did. Paul said he has experienced this and this and this and this. But we get to chapter 12, verse 6, and he said, I could boast, but I'm not going to. But he at least has their attention, does he not? He has their attention now, and he begins to talk about weakness and to talk about challenges and to talk about situations that are the opposite of what that society celebrates. To keep me from becoming conceited, there was given to me a thorn in my flesh. Paul was that hard-charging overachiever, and this thorn, we don't know exactly what it was, but we know that it was a debilitating situation that was part of his life for quite some time. And can't you imagine the prayer of Paul? It's similar to the prayers we might pray. It goes something like this. Dear Lord, you know how much I love you. You know how much I care about your kingdom. You know how much I care about all that's going on. And you know how valuable I am to you. And how much more I could do and how much better I would be if you would take this thorn out of my flesh. Did I hit a little close to home at all when I said it that way? Oh, it's not wrong to ask God to bring healing. It's not wrong to ask God to bring relief from pain. It's not wrong to pray for those things. No, please hear me. It is not wrong in any way. But he's more excited about a relationship with you than he is about pouring out blessings upon you until that relationship has been put in place in its proper way. And Paul said, I've learned the lesson. Paul wasn't praying that prayer in this letter. Paul is saying, I'm pressing on. There are things that are holding me back a little bit. There are some ailments and some afflictions that have come my way. I believe they're from Satan. And though they are, and though I've asked the Lord to remove them, he hasn't done it. But that doesn't stop me from doing what God has called me to do. I will go on. I will persevere. I will push through. I will press on. I will not quit. How about you, my friend? Is there a will not quit attitude in your heart? Is there a will not quit response when challenges come your way? Is there a determination to follow Christ at any cost? No matter what the setting, no matter what the situation, no matter what's going on, no matter what the affliction, no matter what the thorn in the flesh, is there a will not quit that is part of your spiritual DNA today? Let me suggest to you that if walking away because of some affliction is tempting to you, perhaps the relationship has not been put in its proper perspective to begin with. Because I want to tell you, there are people that have this problem and this situation and they just can't work through it, and this is why they don't want to enter into a relationship with our Heavenly Father, because they have discovered that He is not Bill Gates and He's not Jim Walton. He's not Santa Claus. He doesn't give us everything we ask for, but He supplies every need according to His riches and glory through His Son, Christ Jesus. And what we know is that God is not as concerned about your happiness as He is your holiness. Yes, He's concerned about your happiness, but He's not as concerned about your happiness as He is your holiness. And being made right in a relationship with Him that will last for all of eternity. Is that can-do, won't-quit spirit part of your spiritual DNA today? You see, by saying that God is not as concerned about your happiness as much as He is your holiness, that means that God may not always heal you. It means that God may not always remove the pressure that you're under. It means that there are some things that you wish were different that He's not going to allow, because He needs you right where you are. And you are more valuable to Him the way you are than if you happen to experience an answer to prayers that you have been praying about yourself personally. Pastor, you're all messed up. My Bible says God hears and answers every prayer. My Bible says all we have to do is ask, and anything we ask in His name, He's willing to do it. Yes, the promises are there, but there are aspects of those scriptures that come into play as well in regard to living in accordance with the will of God and being in a top-notch relationship with Him when you ask. Watch what comes next. Look at verses 9 and 10. But He said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about My weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness, in insults, in hardship, in persecution, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong." We all know that God is strong. He's all powerful, almighty. We know that about Him. But in our weakness, His strength goes viral. In our weakness, we discover a strength in God that we never would have experienced otherwise. And again, this goes against our culture. This goes against what we hear, what we live around day after day after day. We're taught by culture, "I can do anything I set my mind to do." We're taught in Scripture, "I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength." We're taught by culture, "Never let them see you cry." We're taught by Scripture, "Know that in your weakness, Christ shines." Through Christ, we are given strength, ability, talents, and gifts to use for Him and for His glory. Did you hear me? We are given gifts, talents, strengths, and abilities to use for His glory. I included the word strength in there. He gives us strength to do what He's called us to do. And when we do it in the right relationship with Him, it'll be done to His glory, not ours. It'll be done for Him, not for us. Yes, we will receive some benefits from partnering with Him. But it's for Him, not for us, that things like this are done. And we find ourselves saying that through the weaknesses that we have in our lives, God shines. Not despite the weakness, not working around our weakness, but working right through our weakness, His light shines. It shines through us. And in our weakness, we look stronger because of what Jesus Christ is doing in and through us. Most of you know the name Corrie Ten Boom. She has written several books, one of them entitled Tramp for the Lord. And in the story, in the book, there is the story of a lady that she ran across during the days of the Cold War. Tells about a woman she met in Russia during the Cold War when Christians were being persecuted. The lady was reclining on a sofa almost every day of her life because she had multiple sclerosis. It had taken over her body. Her body was twisted. There was very little she could do. In fact, her husband gave her care for every day. She had no mobility, twisted in every direction. She depended on the pillows to prop her up. The index finger of her right hand was about the only thing she had control over. It was the only thing that she could make operate. So day after day after day, this finger moved across a typewriter keyboard all day and into the night, typing out words. Her husband said there would be times that you would think the finger was not going to move again, and slowly it would get over to the next key and type the next letter. You know what she was doing? She was translating the Bible from another language into Russian so that her friends and her acquaintances could come to know this Jesus Christ that she had a relationship with. Translating Christian books day after day, night after night. Corrie Ten Boom had the opportunity to go visit this lady one day and felt sorry for her. Could sense her pain, could sense her agony, could sense her debilitating situation with MS. And she went over to pray for her and laid hands on her as she prayed. And when the prayer was over, her husband said, "Now, Corrie, please understand, you don't have to feel sorry for us." And she said, "But I can't help it." And he said, "Oh no." He said, "You need to understand the full story. My wife has been working on these translations for years, all through the war. When people were being arrested, when people were being taken to their death in the prison camps, we were left alone. The authorities, the German authorities, looked at us and said, she's so decrepit. These people never can get out and do anything. Leave them alone. No one ever came to check to see what we were doing. No one ever put us under scrutiny or supervision. No one had a clue that my wife, with her one finger, was translating scripture so that it could be read in Russian. And my wife has accomplished more than she ever would have had she not had this infirmity, had MS not taken her body, because had she been up and healthy and well, we would have been arrested and put in the concentration camps with everybody else. But because of her condition, they said, she can't do anything. Some of you have been trapped by the teaching of Satan himself that says, "I don't have it. I'm not worthy. I'm not capable. I'm not able." And you have forgotten that in our weakness, we appear strong. What happened in the translation of materials into Russian would never have happened without the weakness of this lady. There are some things that will never happen any other way except you allowing God to exhibit His strength through you. Can it be done? Absolutely it can. Will it be done? Only you can answer that. But there is more and more and more that we can do when we subject ourselves to the authority of God Himself to work in us and through us to make a difference in our world in His great name. It starts with the relationship. Having a vital relationship with our God through His Son, Jesus Christ. It starts by the cleansing of the heart, cleansing of sin. And it continues day after day after day for the rest of your life as you walk with Him and let Him, in your weakness, make you look stronger than ever. Some of those things that hold people back from getting into a relationship with our God are the very things that get amplified and used in a mighty way once that relationship is established. Would you bow your heads for a moment? How is it with you today? Are there some things that God has been asking of you that, well, let's just call it what it is. You've said, no thanks. I don't think I could do that. I don't think I have the strength. I don't think I have the ability. And He keeps calling and He keeps knocking on the door of your heart. And you keep saying, just don't think I could. But you've been reminded today through the power of Scripture that, yes, you can. It's not what you can do, it's what He can do through you. Would you stand quietly and reverently? And as we close this service, are there some people here today who would say, I've been hiding behind weakness when really I should have been committing my weakness to our Lord for Him to use for His glory. And I just want to step out and come to a place of prayer and commit my life, my talents, my skills, my abilities, no, my weaknesses to God right now. It may have to start by renewing the relationship. There may be some confession of sin that needs to be dealt with today. Anybody like that who would just step out from where you are, come to an altar of prayer? Because in my weakness, His strength shines through. You want Him shining through you right now. Anybody? Well, let me close with this kind of prayer. All of us struggle in one way or another when we compare ourselves to Almighty God. When we look into His face, there are times that instead of seeing His love and His goodness and His provision, Satan wants us to feel condemned. And my prayer for all of us today is that we will continue to be available to Him, weaknesses and all, that we will continue to be available to Him day after day after day, that we will not run from Him, but that we will run toward Him and give Him the opportunity to work and to demonstrate His strength through our lives. Father, You know every person here today. You know the situations they face. You know the burdens they carry. You know the ministries that You have called them to. You know the people You've put them in contact with. You know the ways that You want to use them to make a difference in Your kingdom. Father, may Your will be done in every one of our lives. May Your presence be felt in such a way that it strengthens us from the inside out. May there be a moment right now where every person here is assured that you know their name, you know how it is you want to use them, you know how you want to bless them, but most of all, you know the kind of relationship you want to have with them. Strengthen our relationship with you. Draw us close. When we leave here in just a few moments, may we be able to testify that our relationship with you is stronger than it's ever been before. Work in a mighty way. Let your Spirit be heard as you speak to our hearts, not just in this moment, but all through this coming week. Let your Spirit walk with us, guide us, comfort us, strengthen us, and move us forward. Moving us forward for the kingdom of God and for all that you do, for the ways that you work, for the miracles you allow us to experience. We will thank you and praise you, for it's in the name of Jesus we ask this today. And all the people said, Amen. Pastor Aaron?
And in our weakness we can find freedom in Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going free. Sing this with us.
Go on and speak against my borrowed innocence. The judge is my defense. I'm going free. Right when the gavel fell, I heard the freedom bell ring through the heart of hell. I'm going free. I'm going free.
Sing glory, glory, hallelujah.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. You threw my shackles in the sea. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Jesus is my liberty. I'm going free.
I'm on a narrow road.
I'm on a good back dog, and that's just not who I am.
Lord, I'm a brand new man.
I'm going free. I'm on a narrow road. It's paved with grace and hope. It's gonna lead me home. I'm going free. I'm going free. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Jesus is my liberty. I'm going free.
Sing, I am free.
I am free. I am free.
Your love is my jailbreak.
I'm going free.
you glad? We're free. Free indeed. Hey, real quick, let me tell you what's going on this week. Anybody notice anything crazy up here? I was in construction for years. This is going to be hard to believe, but I'm a better musician than I was a carpenter. Aren't you glad I wasn't your carpenter? I saw a lot of houses without windows, but I'd never seen windows without a house before. I don't know what this means. I was not here when these, I had nothing to do with these, but it looks really cool, doesn't it? I think it has something to do with the women's conference coming up this Saturday. All right, so I don't know if they're going to build a house around that. I have no idea what this means, but it looks really cool. Thank you to Shelley and Michael, and I don't know who else for doing that. It just looks beautiful up here. But this Saturday is a women's conference. We've been telling you about it. This is your last opportunity today to sign up for that. Invite your people. Invite some friends. If today's the last day, you're probably not going to have much time, but I hope you did invite your friends. Mandy Young, Vicky told us a little bit about her last week. Something that just amazes me, and I don't know if this has been told or not, but it's about to be retold. She has a disease that they don't know that anyone else in the world has the disease. Now, that's some serious weakness right there. But in that weakness, she has allowed the Lord to use her and to work through her, and I'm excited for y'all ladies. I don't get to hear her, but for you ladies, come this weekend. Sign up out there, and it's going to be a wonderful time. This Saturday from 10 to 2 o'clock. Cornhole's coming back. Are y'all good at cornhole? In my weakness, he is strong. So I'm going to be good at cornhole because I'm not very good. That starts up next Sunday, October 21st, 5:30 in the gymnasium. And then finally, we're going to have Open Gym coming back tomorrow night. Some of y'all have participated in this before. Open Gym. This is for adults and teenagers. Beginning tomorrow night, 6:30 to 8 o'clock. Show up. Have a good time. I won't be here, but you guys have a good time anyways, would you? Thank you so much for being here. Can I say for Katrina and I echo the pastor, it's such a privilege to serve this congregation. Thank you so much for that opportunity. We love you so much. Have a great day. Go to Sunday school.